c'est l'histoire d'un homme qui tombe d'un immeuble de 50 étages. Le mec, au fur et à mesure de sa chute, il se répète sans cesse pour se rassurer. Jusqu'ici, tout va bien. Jusqu'ici, tout va bien. Jusqu'ici, tout va bien. Mais l'important, c'est pas la chute. C'est l'atterrissage.
Life in the failed urbanization projects conceived by Luc Bouzier in response to the post-war housing crisis, an oversimple, underfunded conception based on quasi-military functionalism, is a daily struggle of percolating tensions, bubbling unrest, unemployment, and lack of agency. The zeitgeist captured remains dormant for a few years, then explodes like a volcano. In October of 2005, this dormant tension and unrest in the Banyuls resurfaced in urban riots. These sites, cités, are spaces of apartheid in Paris. La Haine works as a social commentary on both life in the cités and on the sensationalized media representation of the outer areas of Paris. These cités are called zones of lawlessness that the Republic is called upon to reconquer. The three main characters, Hubert, a wise and pacifistic French African, Vincent, an explosive youth of East European Jewish ancestry, and Saïd, a cool and collected Beur, or person of North African descent, of La Haine, live in a neo-colonial environment, or a colonial state, as the indigenous of the French Republic call it. The media's portrayal of the inhabitants is frequently linked with words like drama, urgency, police, violence, death, explosion, crisis, and malaise. Media plays a large role in how Vince, Hubert, and Saïd see themselves, and how others view them. Looking at the way visual culture is challenged in La Haine, the viewer understands that Kassovitz sought to undermine the way immigrants and the descendants of immigrants were depicted in the traditional French media, and were viewed by an international audience. La Haine, as a piece of visual culture, becomes a site where the visual is contested, debated, and transformed as a constantly challenging place of social interaction and definition in terms of class, gender, sexual, and racialized identity. As Nicholas Mirzoff says, as one mode of representation, reality, loses ground, another takes its place without the first disappearing. This notion that La Haine is attempting to clean the slate, perhaps not to erase previously held ideas, but to add complexity, nuance, and humanity, is similar to Max Silverman's idea of palimpsestic memory. Kassovitz is not the only director to attempt to change the narrative of the often misrepresented and marginalized. French ethnographic filmmaker Jean Rouch employed the same techniques, namely within Chaque Moi Noir. Moi Noir gives cinematic voice to a group of migrant workers from Niger who work in the Ivory Coast. Rouch gave them the creative freedom, allowing for a story told by Africans for Africans. Moi Noir captures the ravages of urbanization and cultural imperialism, the physical and mental toll of poverty. The father of African cinema, Ousmane Sembène, lauded Rouch's film, but said that an African could have made it, but none of us were in a position to do so at the time. Neither Mathieu Kassovitz nor Jean Rouch sought to capitalize off the disenfranchised youth of the Banyuls or Ivory Coast, but they were able to represent them first. Perhaps, as Sembène put it, the film would have been made eventually, but no one in the La Haine circumstances was able to create it and get the attention that he did. Connor Sewells believes that La Haine's story of police brutality, revenge, struggle, and banal daily life is something that renders it universal. The actor who played Saïd believed that
this happened very naturally, like a cry for help, a film for young people made by young people without any marketing strategy other than to be as respectful, honest, and fair as possible.
For some, La Haine represents a complex discourse in racist milieu of surveillance, exclusion, and annihilation. La Haine presents social exclusion as the paramount problem in France. The problems people in the Banyuls, most commonly Black and Maghrebis, face crisis of the order of the everyday, the practices of marginalization, brutalization, and racial terror. Sharma argues that La Haine is complicit in producing a necessitized account of ghetto life predicated on the potent racialized signifier. This so far so good, so far so good, so far so good is an echo of French government's neo-colonial and civil policy creation. So far so good, the colonies are thriving. So far so good, the colonial subjects are fighting in our wars. So far so good, the loyal to the empire soldiers are moving back to the motherland. So far so good, until with an unprecedented boom, the empire blows up, the detritus not only affecting the former colonial countries, but also France. Vince, Hubert, and Saïd feel the suffocating paternalism, but not the camaraderie of the national motto of France.
Liberté, égalité, fraternité.
The movie is polysemic and has many potential takeaways. Though not physically appearing a minority like the dark-skinned Hubert or the brown Saïd, Vince aligns himself with the traditionally oppressed during the riots and in seeking revenge. Mathieu Kassovitz does the same. Kassovitz explores the schisms of the recognized French identity and the treatment of the Black and Beur and the tricolor of the Black, Blanc, et Beur.